Hello, YouTube world. I'm here.
I'm gay and very, so you can get there.
Why?
Anyway, let's get started.
The water looks nice.
Time aspect here, cause I'm already
kind of
feeling
the season. The water looks nice.
Yeah.
You got your 15 minutes of fame. Hope you're happy.
Fucking Christ on a crutch. I can't put shit on.
Sir, hurts a lot. Can get somewhere with me anytime. But anyway, thank you for the compliment, Tay. Let's get started with the true crime. I am now no longer responding to personal comments left on TikTok or on my YouTube because I have a segment to get through and it's a long one and this is going to take a little while. So, let's get started, shall we? David Berkowitz, a.k.a. Richard David Flaco, was born on June 1st of 1953. He was also known as the Son of Sam and the .44 caliber killer and is an American serial killer who pleaded guilty to 8 shootings that began in New York City on July 29th, 1976. I find this ironic because July 29th is my dad's birthday. I'm not going to tell you the year, but it's my dad's birthday. And I was just like, damn, dad's birthday lined up with that shit, huh? Berkowitz grew up in New York City and served in the United States Army. Using a .44 special caliber bulldog revolver, he killed 6 people and wounded 7 others by July of 1975. The killing spree terrorized New Yorkers and gained worldwide notoriety.
Berkowitz, you guys also could hang out with him on filming a transition makeup video.
While leaving letters that mocked the police and promised further crimes, which were highly publicized by the press. Honestly, I don't understand why there is not more control over the media when it comes to murder. Especially if you're suspecting that there's a serial killer. The media's just like, you know what, we're going to take this story and run with it. And I'm like, you don't even realize that that's just... You just think it's worse because then you have panic and you have copycats that come in and blah, blah, blah. It's too much. They need to, like, chill with the media news. So I quit. Berkowitz was arrested on August 10th, 1977 and subsequently indicted for 8 shootings.
I feel like I sound horrible.
He confessed to all of them and
what do you think,
claimed to have been obeying the orders of a demon manifested in the form of a dog belonging to his
Friday?
Sam. Berkowitz
last
was
Friday?
Competent to stand trial.
So, he only a couple days after the murder.
Yeah.
And was found guilty and sentenced.
I just feel like it sounds really bad.
Life sentences. With the possibility of parole after 25 years. No, I get it.
By the way, today's movie is called A Faraway Place, and I am doing kind of the South African flag, as it was a movie about South African pub food, and that's what I decided to do with this one today.
You should have to serve at least half of those life sentences. It's only fair to the people that were murdered, in my opinion. Well, you're a law professional. Apparently, New York feels differently. He admitted that the dog and devil story was a hoax in the course of further police investigations. Berkowitz was also implicated in many unsolved arsons in the city. In the mid-1990s, he amended his confession to claim that he had been a member of a violent satanic cult that orchestrated the incidents as ritual murder. A few law enforcement authorities have said that his claims might be credible, but he remains the only person ever charged with the shootings. A few investigations of the murders began in 1996, but was suspended indefinitely after inconclusive findings. His mother, Elizabeth Betty Broder, grew up as part of an impoverished Jewish family and was a waitress. She married Tony Falco, an Italian American, in 1936. After a marriage of less than 4 years, Tony left her for a prettier woman. Sounds about right for the American man. In 1950, Elizabeth started a relationship with a married man, Joseph Kleinman. 3 years later, she became pregnant with a child, whom she named Richard David Falco. Within a few days of Richard's birth, Elizabeth gave the child away. Although her reasons for doing so are unknown, writers have surmised that Kleinman threatened to abandon her if she kept the baby and used his name. Also, sounds about right for the American man. The infant boy was adopted by Pearl and Nathan Berkowitz of the Bronx. The Jewish-American couple were hardware store retailers of modest means and childless in middle age. Sorry, I have to watch this because this is getting ridiculous. They reversed the order of the boys' first male names and gave him their own surname, raising young David Richard Berkowitz as their only child. Although of above average intelligence, he lost interest in learning at an early age and became infatuated with petty larceny and starting fires. Neighbors and relatives would recall Berkowitz as difficult, spoiled, and a bully. His adoptive parents consulted at least one psychotherapist due to his misconduct, but his behavior never resulted in a legal intervention or serious mention in his school records. He attended public school 123 and public school number 77. I don't know if those are the actual like names of the schools or if there was a reason they left out the names of the schools in research that I found. But for whatever reason, they were just listed by number. There was no names of the schools. Berkowitz's adoptive mother died of breast cancer when he was 14. 14 years old, and his home life strained during later years, particularly because he disliked his adoptive father's second wife. Which, I mean, I can kind of understand that on his front because, like, when you've been raised as long as you have with a set of parents, losing one is difficult enough, but losing one and then having to deal with the, like, replacement of that parent can be exceptionally difficult. It's never easy, you know? In 1971, at the age of 17, Berkowitz joined the United States Army and served in Fort Knox in the United States and with an infantry division in South Korea. After an honorable discharge in June 1974, he located his birth mother, Betty. After a few visits, she disclosed the details of his birth. And he was greatly disturbed, Berkowitz, and who was particularly distraught by the array of reluctant father figures. Forensic anthropologist Ellis Layton describes this discovery as the primary crisis of his life, a revelation that shattered his sense of identity. I said this before, so I'm going to take the time to say it again. I will never understand why it feels like every single serial killer that I study and do segments on served in the fucking military. Like, I know they do, like, psychological evaluations with, like, background checks and all that now, but why the fuck were they doing that in the beginning? You are hearing somebody who clearly would have tested as psychotic a loaded gun and being like, we're gonna teach you how to kill people. Because it's literally I mean, I guess they probably are more dug holes than others, but I don't know. I feel like to me that would say like, oh, a lot of red flags, but what do I know?
Come on!
During the mid-1970s, Berkowitz started to commit violent crimes.
He called it
the first attempt at murder using a knife, then switched to a handgun, and began a lengthy crime spree throughout the New York boroughs of the Bronx, Queens, and Brooklyn. He sought female victims. He was purportedly most attracted to white women with long, dark, blonde hair. Although during the crime spree, two victims, he infamously committed some of his attacks. 12 women have boyfriends in parked cars. I don't know why, but for the longest time, I just mixed up the Zodiac Killer and gave it a good thing about the Zodiac Killer. And I, like, feel really guilty about that now, because, like, I never realized that I, like, merged those two together, I guess, in a way. I was like, how did I get that? But the Zodiac Killer did not kill people. I mean, he did kill a taxi cab driver. It doesn't matter. I mixed them up. Some say I'm killed people in parked cars. That don't. So, there's a segment on the Zodiac Killer. He exhibited an enduring enjoyment of his activities, often referring to the scenes of his crime. Berkowitz claims that when he was 22 years old, he committed his first attack on Christmas Eve 1975 while he used a hunting knife to stab two women in Co-op City. The first alleged victim, a Hispanic woman, was never identified by police. The second was Michelle Foreman, 15, a sophomore at Truman High School, whom he stabbed 6 times on a bridge near Dreiser Loop, and whose injuries were serious enough for him to be hospitalized. Berkowitz was not suspected of these crimes, and soon afterward, he relocated to an apartment in Yonkers. The first.
Who the fuck is out there now? Will you let them in?
No, I don't like that.
On July 9th, 1976. Gloria, 18, an emergency medical technician, and her boyfriend, Jody Valencia, 19.
Who was it?
No.
What is it?
Hold on. It's not her boyfriend. And her friend, Jody Valenti, 19. I read that so wrong. A nurse were sitting in Valenti's double-parked Oldsmobile discussing their evening at Peachtree's, a new Rochelle disco fete. Donna opened the car door to leave and ordered a man quickly approaching the car. Startled and angered by the man's appearance, he said, "Now what is this?" The man produced a pistol from the paper bag that he carried and crouched. He raised one elbow on his knee, aimed his weapon with both hands, and fired. Jody survived her injury and said that she did not recognize him. Now, I've gone shooting. I've been with my aunts and uncles who live out in kind of the country areas, and they shoot and all that jazz. And I was never taught to crouch when shooting. So I don't know if that's just something that he felt he needed to do, or what, but I've just never, I mean, has anybody else ever been shooting that way?
Do you know where the sunscreen is?
I'm thinking of the car.
Actually, my lap isn't that bad, Boogeyman. I just had surgery recently, so it sounds a little different than it normally does. Admittedly, it probably.
Yeah, he said I had a lap. She's a 10, but she has a lap like a starting car engine.
I've
also recently had surgery, bud.
Residential area of Flushing, Queens, next to Bound. Oh, sorry. That's the next to Bowen Park. Carl Guaro 20, a city gangster green guard, and Ray Van Kuhn 18, a community college student, a park guard, and the base of his battery. Both survived the attack, although Carl was a medical
Sorry about that. Anyway, sure YouTube will yell at me because I didn't get there fast enough, but whatever. This is a look for a faraway place. Have a wonderful day, y'all, and I will see you all tomorrow. Make good choices. Don't do anything I wouldn't do. And be cautiously kind to others.